You're listening to Wasteoids.
This podcast is sponsored by BetterHelp. Without a healthy mind, being truly happy and at peace is hard. The good news is therapy works. But what is therapy exactly? Well, it's whatever you need it to be. Maybe you're not feeling motivated right now and would like some tools to help. Maybe you're feeling insecure in relationships or at work or not dealing well with stress. Whatever you need, it's time to stop being ashamed of normal human struggles and start feeling better, because you deserve to be happy. And now you don't have to worry about finding an in-person therapist near you to help. BetterHelp is customized online therapy that offers video, phone, and even live chat sessions with your therapist, so you don't have to see anyone on camera if you don't want to. It's much more affordable than in-person therapy, and you can start communicating with your therapist in under 48 hours. Join the millions of people who are seeing what online therapy is really about. It's always a good time to invest in yourself because you are your greatest asset. As a special offer to Wasteoids listeners, you can get 10% off your first month of professional therapy at betterhelp.com/wasteoids. That's betterhelp.com/wasteoids. Thanks again to BetterHelp for sponsoring this episode.
Hello, everybody. It's the Spindle Podcast with Marc and John.
Hi, and welcome to the Spindle, a podcast about 7-inch records. I'm Marc.
And I'm John.
And in each episode, we talk about one 7-inch record, hopefully give you some insight into it that you haven't heard before. We both got into music in the 80s and 90s when 7-inches were super important, especially on independent labels. So that's the era we mostly draw from, but we'll pick some stuff earlier or later than that too. And either way, we'll try to keep it short and to the point, just like 7-inches do. So since this is our first episode, just a little bit of background. We've both written a bunch about music, researched a lot about music, played in bands. We were actually in a band together in DC called The Plums. When DC area is where both of us have lived most of our lives, and John's still there. I'm in Arizona now. And mostly we're just big music fans, and we also know a few things about the history behind some of these records too. So that's a little heads up about who we are and where we're coming from. And on this first episode, we wanted to talk about Hüsker Dü's 7-inch 8 Miles High, backed with Masochism World, which came out on SST in the late spring of 1984. So John was actually around when this, I was around when this record came out, but I didn't know Hüsker Dü at the time, but John actually bought it when it came out, right?
Yes, I did. I was very excited to. I was stoked because they were my favorite band and they covered my favorite song. So I was cool. Like over the moon.
And you actually heard it on the radio?
I did. Well, it's a WHFS in DC, mm-hmm. which was a bit of a ringer because it's like the only commercial station in the whole country that might have played it. Mm-hmm. I was driving west on 50 and heard it and was just like, what the heck, and drove to the store and bought it immediately. I couldn't wait.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
And I guess for anybody who somehow would not know it, I'm sure everybody listening is probably does, but it's a cover of a Byrds song.
Yes. Which is its own greatness. And just the Byrds are one of my favorite bands too. So that combo it just took me apart.
That's awesome. So Hüsker Dü, Minnesota band, they had a couple, how many records they have out at this point? Probably three albums, two albums.
They had out, Landspeed record, mm-hmm. two singles. I think Metal Circus was the most recent thing that had come out or so of 83, cool. late fall 83. Mm-hmm. And this was the next thing that came out after that.
Cool. Yeah. And I mean, later that year, Zen Arcade, the double album, which became, was one of their most famous records, came out. And this was recorded in the same sessions as that, but they decided to release it as a single on its own.
Just a standalone single, which is a great idea.
Yeah,
definitely primed the pump for Zen Arcade.
The cool thing about it is it's not a surprise that they recorded at the same time. It sounds like the stuff that was on Zen Arcade, but I think it made a lot of sense not to put it on Zen Arcade. I think it
100%.
a little bit odd on an album, and it so works just completely as its own statement.
Yeah, I mean, it seems to me that they probably always intended it to be kind of its own thing. Like even when they recorded, because of course SST famously cheap, And they would probably be like, okay, these sessions are for you guys to record a single and your album. Mm-hmm. And so we're going to put the single out first. Hopefully the single, probably some of the idea of the single is to raise enough money to press the freaking record. Right. And I mean, it's, you know, right. That's, I think that's probably correct.
Right. And, no, it sounds right.
And so then, you know, it's a great idea though. It's, it is definitely part of the record, but also its own way, kind of separate from it. Mm-hmm. And it's the record sort of presages the how psychedelic the Zen Arcade is. Mm-hmm. It's like a kind of a shot across the bow of that, letting people know that it wasn't going to be the usual hardcore.
Do you remember if there was like a, would this have been a weird thing to do to cover what at the time, I mean, the term classic rock probably didn't even really exist, but people might've still thought of it that way. You know, this is a classic rock song and a hardcore band is covering it. Would that have been a weird thing? At the time?
I don't, not as much as you would think. Cause I mean, like they had already covered Donovan on Everything Falls Apart. They Sunshine Superman. People covered stuff all the time, kind of sarcastically, but kind of not, you know, like the Circle Jerks did Golden Shower of Hits. And I mean, I think it just depended on what you were doing. I think everybody, that's a, the 8 Mile High is the kind of song that people would, you wouldn't complain about people really covering that. That's not really a sellout song to cover. You know what I mean? It's there are songs you could probably cover like that, or but that would not be one of them. And it, it fits so well in their aesthetic that I think that there was just nobody, I can't recall anybody questioning it or thinking it was a sellout move or something.
Right. Like yeah. It's a funny thing. I mean, I back in those days, I remember always thinking if a band's covering something, especially a punk or underground band covering a famous song, it's, it, they're either making fun of the song or they're trying to be ironic, but this is pretty far from any of that.
It's a feral. This cover is absolutely feral. Like it's, it goes even beyond what a lot of hardcore is, way more intense than a lot of regular old hardcore would be, just emotionally and sonically. It's whether it's hardcore or not is they've like gone beyond that. It's some of the sound of it is almost kind of industrial in a way.
It's sonically definitely more extreme than the Birds song, but the kind of tension that the Birds were playing around with, not necessarily an homage to that, but it's consistent with it.
Yeah, I think that it was very conscious because 8 Miles High was a very important single for the Birds. And they considered it, it was considered to be a very forward thinking, sort of a good vibrations level single at the time, you know, to incorporate the, it's a, it's, I don't, you know, if you haven't, if people listening haven't listened to it for a while, go listen to it. It's unbelievable that it got on the charts at all. It opens with a free jazz guitar solo. It's got this pump and bass. They jam out most of the time, you know, and it's very intense. And it's probably one of the more intense things that would have been played on the radio in 1966 for sure. Just sonically and emotionally and otherwise. Difference in the way that they both approach it is really, really cool because the Birds being the Birds, their approach is, it's the whole song is about anxiety. You can, you know, people think it's about drugs, but it's really about anxiety if you listen to the words. And they're playing it cool. They're trying to tamp it down. You know, they're like, I don't want to seem anxious. I want to be cool. You know, I'm on a jet. I'm a bird, but I'm freaking out. Whereas Hüsker Dü, it's the anxiety's just let loose and becomes this almost like a tantrum-y kind of like overwhelming. I'm just overwhelmed by it. I don't know where to go with it except to scream and, you know, break down. It breaks down at the edges sonically. It breaks down vocally. Mm-hmm. You know, it becomes kind of its own sort of blur. As it goes on, and it's the very similar. The birds thing does the same thing, but it's just those years of separation and Hüsker Dü kind of knowingly taking it on meant that they took it that extra step further beyond what the birds were doing and were able to.
Yeah, and I guess I mean they've been using this as a live song for a while before they recorded it. In fact, I think it was like a relatively frequent encore song, and the recording ends up having. I mean, it feels sort of almost like a live. I mean, when you listen to the B-side, which actually is live, you realize that the A-side is very much a studio creation, but it's still the energy and the way, especially the way that he kind of goes really off the deep end at near the last part of the song is very similar to probably what they were doing on stage.
There's a lot of remarkable sonic moments in that track that just blow my mind. The guitar playing is absolutely off the chain the entire song. And at the end, it's almost like he has to kind of get the guitar back under control there for a second. Like he hits these three chords as the song goes out at the end, where it's almost like he's like grabbing the guitar. Okay, let's bring you back in, you know.
Right.
He sounds like he's jumping up and down when he's singing it. It's got to be one of the most intense vocal performances I've ever heard anybody give. Like if you throw on headphones and listen to that, you can hear him like huffing and puffing. And he's like obviously just in it, like neck deep. You know, and it's very, I don't know, it's wild to listen to. Like when I was a teenager, I related heavily to it. And now I'm like, oh, you poor thing. You know, I want to take him and give him a hug. You know,
right, right.
It's going to be okay, Bob. I'm sure Bob, he feels the same way about it. It'd be hard to listen to that. Like it's such an intense emotional performance, like that accessing that spot. Like, I don't know that that's, you don't want to go there. Like as a person, like it's not necessarily good. To go to those places all the time. Like you did it, you made a record of it, and it's like, maybe I need to do it.
Wild thing to me that I love about that end too is like probably the first time you hear, I can't really remember the first time I heard it, but I imagine like that the way he sings at the end sounds pretty unhinged, almost to the point where it's like, oh, this is sort of a primal scream. But the listen to it more, there's music inside of the way he's screaming, and it actually kind of goes with the guitar that he's playing in almost like a weirdly rhyming way.
No, it does. Yeah, very much so. But it is very, I don't know. I mean, it's pretty. he, you know, he's one of those dudes, he will just go there. And so if he can get in that, I guess if he can get in that performance mode and make it, I mean, like it's wild. The connection with the birds thing, you were talking about covers. I think they meant it as like that bird signal single Amos High was supposed to be a big deal. Like they meant it as like this major statement, you know, this is like they were ahead of the game and everybody's going to have to catch up, which was kind of true. And so I think Hüsker Dü was doing, you know, that was, they picked that song and that single deliberately in a way to echo that, you know, like that's one of the first psychedelic singles, one of the first, you know, and they're like, we're sick of hardcore as it is. We want to break out of that, you know? And I think that was sort of a signal of that, that they could take that intensity of hardcore, but you don't have to sit there and just play hardcore all the time. You can jump beyond that, move into other realms. And that single was a very early precursor, because it was that, it's funny because it came out like My War came out around that time, Me Puppets 2, all of these within about 5 or 6 months of each other. That whole scene that had started off with bands like Minor Threat and stuff like that had like kind of spun apart, so that you had people who wanted to stay in that what I would call kind of skinheady type of hardcore music, And obviously the people who had gotten originally into that stuff were more eclectic listeners, and they got sick of playing the same stuff all the time.
Right.
And that includes almost every one of those major early bands you can think of, whether it's De Kreutzen or Necros or Henry Rollins or Black Flag or Minor Threat, or all of those bands did that for like a year and a half. And they're like, well, okay, good. Now what? Most of the really good ones went and did more interesting stuff kind of after that. I think that the Hüsker Dü thing was like, you know, you don't have to be a meathead about it.
The Spindle will be right back after a brief word from our sponsor.
From cult horror and sci-fi to B-movie splatterfests, to underground music documentaries, concert films, public access shows, indie label showcases, and original programs, Night Flight Plus is the coolest place online for weird and riveting viewing. Right now, Wastoids listeners can get $10 off an annual membership. That means access to Night Flight's library for only $29.99 a year. Head to www.nightflightplus.com/promo code and enter Wastoids in all caps. That's W-A-S-T-O-I-D-S. Enter promo code Wastoids at nightflightplus.com/promo code and get back in the days.
And now back to the show.
It's funny, going through those songs for the purpose of talking about them made me realize how much weirder, not that the Bird Song isn't pretty obviously weird for the context of the time and for being a pop song, but it's even weirder than I remembered. Like, yeah. especially the guitar playing. I mean, the guitar solo in that is like, it's definitely fucked up. And it's like he's making weirdly deliberate I don't know if it's mistakes you would call it, but just everything
he's
is
playing
kind
free,
of,
he's deliberately playing free jazz. He's right, like, right, he's right, trying right. to ape Coltrane, and he's trying to ape Albert Ayler and that kind of thing.
Right.
So that's the sound of it. Like, they were listening to Ravi Shankar and John Coltrane. And so that sounds like Coltrane. Bum, ba-dum, 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 ba-dum. You know, it's like Leo or something like that. So yeah, that opens the freaking song, that solo. Right. You know what I mean? Like, it's not like they started off with they start off with the most intense part of the song.
Right.
And it got radio play at all is insane. Like, anybody who's like, all right, I could have gotten a number one or something, they're out of their minds.
Right, because there's this weird myth about it having been banned from the radio. But,
yeah,
I mean, it made the charts, so it couldn't have been that banned.
No, and if it got, I mean, that song getting to number, it was like got probably to 10 or 12 or somewhere there into the top 15. That's just bananas. Like, that's got to be one of the most, like, nobody would say the Hüsker Dü version was expected to get into the top 20.
Right.
And the idea that it got there and it's regarded as a classic. Like, people don't just sit there and say, oh, that's the weirdest song that ever happened. Right. Everybody's just like, oh, 8 Miles High, it's great. You know, yeah. You hardly ever hear anybody say anything bad about it.
No, that's true. And the interesting thing too, the kind of thing that parallel that I'm sure Mold must be thinking about a little bit is, so they start with the guitar part that sounds nothing like the Birds part, other than it's got some same notes, but it's got that same kind of, this is what you're going to be hearing on this record right away. Like, it doesn't delay. I mean, he immediately goes into that heavy, harsh guitar
he
sound.
He plays the bass line because he's got to start the song. But he's not letting Greg take the opening, whereas Chris Hillman played the opens with the bass, that boom, 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 boom,
right,
boom, boom.
Right.
And the Hüsker Dü goes, trank, 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 trank,
right.
Which is, you're right. Yeah, it's perfect. It's like, it is, I think, very sort of a knowing echo of the original.
So that Mold sound, that guitar sound, which, you know, he kind of was always part of, even as they got cleaner sounding and everything, there was always sort of a distinction to his guitar sound. Do you think he had a specific pedal setup or something that got, or is it just about volume mostly that made his
I read somewhere, so the whole thing with him is he uses very light strings and a light pick and a lot of volume and a lot of overdrive. And so anytime I saw them, he was playing through a very powerful, at least one very powerful stack, which would be twin through a Marshall, so like two what they call 100-watt amplifiers, which are huge, and he would have them running, as far as I could tell, flat out, like both the three times I saw them. They were, at the time, I think they were by far the loudest band I saw couple times I saw them. But there was also, I don't know, as pure decibels, but it's been kind of lost to time how intense and noisy his guitar sound and extreme it was. Like, so much stuff has happened since then that you forget that there was nobody that sounded like that. Like it sounded like, you know, they chucked cats in a dryer and turned it on. And that's like the sound of Hüsker Dü live. It's really intense. And he was, I guess, trying, he's like, oh, well, I want to combine the Hollies and Throbbing Gristle. Mm-hmm. And that would be kind of, yep, you nailed it. And so very, very deliberately extreme industrial, not in the Ministry sense, but industrial in the Throbbing Gristle, Einstürzende Neubauten, original, you know, hitting things with girders, industrial.
Right.
I think noise itself, that cathartic, like seeing them was like a physically wrenching thing. I'm sure other people would say the same thing. It's like really intense to see them. And that was back before earplugs and anything.
Right.
So you would come out of a show of theirs, like your whole body would just be vibrating from the volume and intensity.
Right. And that's just sort of another way that they connect pretty well to the original, is that there's a drone to his sound, because he lets it ring out so long.
Well, the drone is the part of the song. And I think some people don't quite hear that, but the Bob Mould certainly did. Like he focused on that was a key part of the, like he obviously focused on that drone, in that song. And that's, he builds sort of the guitar around, like that guitar just drones, like you're saying, through the whole thing. Mm-hmm. It kind of covers, because the Birds had two guitars. And so he kind of covers both guitars that way.
And the sort of one of the other interesting things that when I was reading about this song in a couple different books, so sort of at the same time in the early 80s was this Paisley Underground thing was happening, which is like Rain Parade and Three O'Clock.
Dream Syndicate. Yeah. The 3 o'clock.
Right. Right. And they were considered sort of more directly an update of what the Birds, like psychedelic stuff the Birds were doing somewhat. It's just funny because Grant Hart, the Hüsker Dü drummer, I don't know if we mentioned his full name yet, but he, in that Andrew Earle's book about Hüsker Dü, he's like, he actually asked him about those bands, and he's like, those bands wouldn't add anything to the sound. If they had covered this song, it wouldn't have sounded much different from the original. We created an entirely new song out of it, which I think is, he's accurate about. But the funny thing is, Mould seemed to think the opposite, that he sort of thought they were playing it just like the Birds, which I think he's being a little facetious there. But also, I think he did sincerely want it to sound the way he heard that Birds song himself.
Yeah. Oh, well, I mean, I think they're both right. Like, I think that they played it like the Birds, but I think they mean, Bob Mould might mean he's playing it like if they were the Birds and they were in the studio, this is what it would be like. You know what I mean? Like if the Hüsker Dü was the Birds, and if Hüsker Dü wrote A Miles High, and if Hüsker Dü played High Miles High, that's kind of the approach. And Grant, I think he's kind of right about those bands. They definitely like to, you know, we like a lot of that stuff, like Opal and things like that. And but they definitely would be more reverent, I think, to that. Like you'd hear a 12 string in there, and they would probably, it would probably be tamer than the Birds original version, you know, even though I love those bands. But I just think they would not, none of those bands, except for the Dream Syndicate, really would get out there.
Right.
Like Hüsker Dü would, you know. Yeah. And Hüsker Dü live, they would jam for like 15, 20 minutes at a shot. Like they would just do complete noise free jams. Mm-hmm. I mean, Reoccurring Dreams was stuff they would do that live. I saw them play Helter Skelter for 10 minutes, you know. They just took on songs as their own anyway. And I think that's what Bob Mould means in a way.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I could definitely see that they're sort of like, what if we pretended we were the Birds, not so much what if we sounded like the Birds.
Well, I mean, it's like a deeper, it's like almost like method acting in a way. Like it's deeper than that. It's like you try to look from inside the Birds,
right,
but be yourself. Mm-hmm. You know, just accepting that you would sound different anyway. Does that make sense? A little meta.
Yeah. And speaking of live, so the B-side of this is a live song that the studio version ended up coming out on Zen Arcade called Masochism World. And it's a good song. I mean, and it's a good recording. I mean, it's an interesting recording of it. It sounds good, but it seems sort of purposefully not competing with the A side at all.
It's a definite B side.
Yeah.
And meant to, I'm sure they, you know, why would you, what would compete with that A side?
Right.
Like, what would you put? I mean, I suppose you could maybe make some insane double A side where, you know, they put whatever on the beast, but I think anything else, because it's a cover, would be swamped.
And I mean, this is something we'll probably talk about as we go along with every episode, but there's different kind of 7-inches, and one kind was, this is a single, a song single, and we've got to put something on the back, but we don't want you to be playing that one on the radio. We want
right, exactly. So, yeah. And so you put that's true. Yeah. One-sided singles, basically. Mm-hmm. You know, they know nobody's going to play a live version of something. They want to make sure that everybody's playing 8 Miles High, I think. Right. And that's more of a 60s thing in some ways, though, I think, where you would have publishers insisting a certain song would have to get played.
Right.
And so that would, you get all these like publishing music business games with what song is on the A side and what's on the B side and who's making money on that. I don't think that was happening with SST.
Yeah. Yeah. Which is funny because, I mean, at that point, that's not such an anomaly, but it won't be too long getting it toward the 90s where the idea of a one song 7-inch is not as big a thing anymore. I mean, bands are trying to shove as many short songs as they can and make EPs out of 7-inches or make them double A sides or whatever. I think that's more the trend later.
Well, that makes no sense at all. Single has the Mary Tyler Moore theme on the B side,
really, right?
Kind of
right.
A double A sided single that you would just flip back and forth. At least I did back in the day, just over and over. So they weren't averse to that. And there was one where you would think if it's a radio airplay, you would definitely want Makes No Sense at All to be the one that everybody's playing.
Right.
But instead they made that great single.
So. Right. Well, this is such a great record, and it's wild because on the one hand, I would say for the time period, it's probably one of the best independent singles, you know, maybe of that little stretch of time or even of the decade, yet it's probably not their peak just because they kept going higher and higher for a while there.
It's gotta be one of the best. I mean, just at least as far as rock covers go, I think people acknowledge that's one of the best of all time. Like anybody who hears it is just like astonished by it, you know?
Right. Right.
But it's true. You can't play it on the radio. You couldn't play that. It's too much.
Yeah.
Like it would just blow out any rock radio station, you know? Mm-hmm. I mean, it worked on college radio, but I can't imagine. Imagine DC 101, you know, they play Puddle of Mud and then and you're just like, no, it would just, it's too intense for that kind of thing. Mm-hmm. But they just knocked it out of the park, you know, like just really good material, good performance, great band.
Yeah. And just such a rich thing because it's connected to something that they were conscious of. It wasn't just a cover. They were thinking about it and doing something with it that makes it interesting.
Right, every time you hear it, right, you know? Right. And the whole right with the birds and the psychedelic thing and the Hüsker Dü, you know, it's crazy. Like I mean, it shows it's thought, like you're saying, well thought out. You know, you choose the right material, and it's pretty cool. It was a great idea.
Yeah, I agree. Cool. But thanks everybody for listening. I also want to say thanks, quick thanks to Honey Radar for giving us our theme song that you heard at the beginning of the episode. And they're a great band out of Philadelphia that's made a lot of great singles. And hopefully one day we'll talk about one of their singles on the podcast. But I hope you enjoy that song. And I hope you tune in with us next time. Thanks a lot.
The Spindle is produced by John Howard and me, Marc Masters. I'm also the audio editor. Our theme song is by the great band Honey Radar. Our podcast is brought to you by Wastoids, audio and video from Hello Merch. Find more podcasts and videos at wastoids.com. And please leave a rating and a review of our podcast wherever you listen to podcasts. Thanks.